Environment variables allow you to hide away important or even sensitive data from your application's code. At a high level, environment variables are variables that are defined by your application's environment instead of your application itself. An environment is a place where your application will be executed, and typically your application's environment is the computer's operating system. You can actually run a command in your computer's terminal to see all of its environment variables. In macOS specifically, you would run print env to see your computer's environment variables. These environment variables hold a lot of important information like your computer's path file, which user is logged in, or even what language your computer is in. But later in this video, you'll see that environment variables can hold a lot more, like API keys, auth tokens, or even passwords. Also, this information isn't completely static. You can create your own environment variables. In macOS, you would use the following syntax to create an environment variable. You use the export keyword with the name of the variable and then the value that you want to assign to that variable. And if you wanted to check to see if you successfully created that variable, you would want to use the following syntax, where you use the echo keyword and then the dollar sign right before the variable you want to print. It's important to note that if we take this approach of creating environment variables inside of our terminal, they're always going to be temporary. This means that if I close my terminal instance, they're all going to be gone by the time I start up a new terminal instance. Alright, this is all great if you're working inside of your terminal, but how would you grab these variables in your JavaScript applications? Well, if you have a Node.js app, you can access these variables using an object called process.env. So here I have a really short Node script where I'm printing out my process.env objects. And once I print out process.env, I can see all of my environment variables inside of my Node.js app. This is pretty great because now I have direct access to all my environment variables in JavaScript. You can think of process.env in this case as a tunnel that brings in environment variables into an application. Environment variables are specific to your application's environment though, so the moment you switch environments, so does your environment variables. Oftentimes this poses problems for applications that might run in different environments, but this isn't actually a real problem since there's something called the dotenv file which allows you to define your environment variables and use those environment variables regardless of the environment that your app is in. So let's answer the question of what a .env file is. You can actually define environment variables a number of different ways, but the most popular way for web dev projects is to place all your environment variables inside of your .env file. The contents of this file is pretty straightforward since it's just a list of variables with their values. So this is what a typical .env file would look like. You would have a list of variables, typically in all caps using underscores for spaces, with their values directly being assigned to them. You can also add comments by using hashtags and adding whatever text to be your comment. With these .env files, we make our environment variables portable, meaning whichever project I drop this file into, that project's code has access to those environment variables. .env files become extremely crucial for a lot of projects since they contain a lot of important information from auth tokens, API keys, passwords, and even more. So if you ever decide to use .env files, which I highly recommend doing, it's always great practice to make sure that you keep that file in a safe, private location. So now that we have our .env file, let's take a look at how a typical JavaScript project would try to grab hold of those environment variables in that file. As mentioned earlier, in JavaScript applications, the process.env object gets loaded whenever you build your application code. The main responsibility of this object is to make sure that all of the environment variables live on itself. So what this means for us is that all of our environment variables that live inside of the .env file should be made accessible via the process.env object. So we can see how this works in the following code block. So here I have my two files, one is my .env file while the other contains some of my application code. So you can see on the first line that I create a constant called API key, which is being assigned the value that comes from process.env.api key. So you can see inside of my .env file that I define my API key variable. This means that I can access that same variable inside my application code using process.env.api key. So this is a super common practice in web development. Anytime you see process.env, that should signal to you that your application code is trying to grab an environment variable that's not defined inside of the application code itself. But it's super important to note that applications that get ran in front-end environments don't have out-of-the-box automatic support for grabbing environment variables and placing them on the process.env object. So to solve this problem, you want to import the npm package .env. To take advantage of this package, within your terminal, navigate to your project directory and then call npm install .env to install the .env package into your application. After installing the .env package, you want to go back into your application code. You want to go to whatever JavaScript file that's responsible for loading up your entire application. So you can see here that I updated my last code block where I'm adding two extra lines. I import the dotenv npm package at the very top and then call dotenv config, which will set up my project so it will have the ability to access its environment variables using the process.env object. Just with these two lines, you're able to grab access to all of your environment variables. All right, so we've covered the technical side of environment variables and .env files, but let's try to understand some of the immediate benefits that come from using them. Let's say that you've completed a mobile app that integrates with a remotely hosted backend service. You want to push all of your code to GitHub so others can see your awesome work, but you realize that you have API keys, auth tokens, passwords, and more embedded within your application code that allows your app to interact with that remotely hosted backend service. If you didn't know much about environment variables, you would probably only have two options. One, not push your code at all to avoid the security risk of exposing those sensitive keys to the outside world. Or two, push your code and hope that no one will take the time to breach your application. One option is definitely worse than the other, but both options are pretty bad. In both cases, you aren't able to confidently share your code with the world without creating security risks. But environment variables and .env files solve this problem by allowing you to place all of your passwords, auth tokens, API keys, URLs, whatever you want, inside of a separate private file. By doing that, you're taking out all that sensitive information that's embedded inside your application code, and you can now share it with the outside world. It's important to note that if you are going to take advantage of .env files, make sure that you add it to your Git ignore, so whenever you want to push your changes, Git doesn't accidentally include .env in your push. That's it for environment variables and .env files. I hope you start using them in your applications because it makes them just so much easier to move around and share with other people, and by the end of the day, a lot more secure. If you enjoyed this video, please drop a like and subscribe to the channel for more content like this. If you want to get in touch, ask me a technical question, recommend a new video idea, anything in between, you can leave a comment down below or you can send me a DM on Twitter where I talk about JavaScript and a variety of different things. And with that, I'll see you on the next one.